Welcome to Sip and Chat, the podcast.
Welcome. We are glad to have you all in joining us again. In the panel, we have Rusty, Anthony, Chef, Uncle Chef, as we like to call him, and myself. You know, the other guys up to no good as usual, doing the best that Lotions could do and following up with their work. Today, we want to talk about music. We lost, for those of you all in our age brackets, we lost an icon or a mogul in our industry, well, in our teenage years coming up, DMX.
Let us pray. I thank you, Lord, for today, and I will pray for tomorrow. Let your thought and my heart go hand in hand. I first thought but to start, but I stand a man. And for as long as I can, as long as you permit me, please give me the strength I need to live. Bear with me. Amen.
Yes, at home we have lost some prominent people as well, but I think tonight I want to touch on DMX because, you know, apart from his being so vocal about drug addiction, mental illness, he was still able to be labeled almost an icon in the hip-hop industry. So I want to talk about that, you know, what are you all thinking? What do you all think about DMX? Did he have an impact on your lives growing up? Anybody could go. I will tell you. Well, matter of fact, let's start with what do you have a favorite DMX experience? And if so, what is it that you could recall?
I'm a DJ and I used to work at a music store. I first heard about DMX in 1997. I was about 18. And when DMX's first album came out, it was like a few weeks before my birthday, I was almost 19. Back then, you couldn't get albums that had the explicit lyrics stick on them in Trinidad. Right. It was hard to get. So for instance, me getting a DMX album to listen to was probably a hard and rare thing. And I remember the second time that DMX's album came out, nobody knew that it was supposed to come out. So I was going to buy for the store, went to my partner, walk in. This was like the week before Christmas. And I see 10 DMX, Flesh of My Flesh, Blood Is My Blood Day. And I was like, where'd that come from? We now get that from Miami. I was like, let me get all.
You're all.
You're all. Because nobody knew DMX was coming out with an album in December. And I knew the first album, which had the single Get At Me Dog, which was it was a hard, grimy song. The second album, and that album also had Rough Riders Anthem that everybody, like when you hear starting a party, everybody going wild. My favorite song actually came on the second album, which was Slippin', because Slippin', he actually got into his life and got into where he came from, which was a child who was more or less abandoned by his mother, had to fend for himself, take care of himself, and he spoke about how his life shaped him. And that kind of personal getting into how he was actually kind of gripping, because not much rappers were speaking about their lives in such a personal manner. Yeah. That and the
so to speak, that even though he was more, you know, gangster rap and stuff, he could have still come and say, give a personal touch.
Yeah. Yes. Mm-hmm. And the other thing that struck me was that he, despite the fact that he is a hardcore rapper, is that he had a faith that you would believe that was unshakable. For me, as a young person, and at that time I was heavy into church, I can reconcile how he being a rapper, or he being hardcore as he was also unshakable in his faith. But when you listen to it, you realize he had faith, he had conviction, and he had believed in what he believed in. And so much so that every last album that he had ended with a prayer.
Mm-hmm. Roxy, what about you? Do you have any favorite DMX moments or memories?
I grew up on music. I always listening to music, rap, especially gangster rap and stuff. I grew up on listening to that. I mean, not that my parents enjoyed that. And I actually had DMX's first album, which would I have Rough Riders Anthem, right? That was on the first album.
That was the second one, I think.
No, I was probably about 9 or 10 or something, and I got my hands on a copy. And there I had it playing, boy, and my parents came home, and I didn't know that I was home. And my father heard this thing playing on the stereo system. Boy, that man eject that CD so quick and fling that like a frisbee.
You fling it?
What? Brother, nah, man, that's somewhere in somebody yard in the bush somewhere. That man fling that thing like a frisbee.
Unbridled disrespect of parents.
he said, boy, don't let me hear you listen to that jackass music in this house. Eh? Me and grow you up, so. Yeah, that's how it was. But, you know, people always attach gangster music to with a bad vibe. It have a bad connotation to it. And,
Rightfully so.
Not for me, because I know no gang, and I talk about this men like 50 Cent and well, DMX, all these kind of men.
In other words, Rusty, you will live vicariously through them.
Yeah. That's exactly what happened. And I think that helped me get through a lot of the things that I've been through as well. Like, when I go in through hard times, I tend to rap to gangs. I rap and take it in, and that calms me down. It really does. It helps me. It really, really does.
Come here, Uncle Chef, in the building. Well, why are we waiting on Chef? I could tell you about me. I mean, I didn't even know who DMX was. I remember my first experience, or my memory of DMX is that I was in a Mayfair. Those of you who are accustomed or know about the went to school in Port of Spain and know about the entertainment circuit in Port of Spain, I was in Bishopsburg. He was in Bishops. And if you went to school in Tongue and you know Bishops coming up, you had to be in that dance. And that year was the first year Bungie came out with Send That Rhythm, Mad, Mad, that song. So that was going on. And you know, I Bishops are feeling nice. What? Everybody there, we having a time. And then the Rough Riders anthem rhythm started. And I was like, okay, no, not that. That is Bungie. Sorry. edit that. Eh? But the Rough Riders anthem start up. Right? And the whole party start to sing, stop, drop, shut him down, open up, shop. And I was like, what is this? What song is this? Everybody was like, oh. And I was like, this song bad. What is this? Boom, DMX. So that's the first time I hear Rough Riders anthem. I was like, all right, not bad. And then from there, you know, I started to follow X. You know, he came on the movie screens and all of that. And like, my favorite album from DMX is, and then there was X. When he had the songs with One More Road to Cross, Same Old Shit Dog, That's a Different Day, the most famous song with Cisco. What these girls want, you understand? But
you find out what they want yet?
Favorite DMX tracks,
you by chance find out what they really want yet?
No, so we find out still. X1 and we still don't know. There was one to something. You understand? We even know what Cisco is, and we even know. I feel Cisco wants to find out what they really want. That's why we can't find Cisco. You understand? But on the real, I mean, X, it's as Rusty says, it's a pump-up music. You know, you listen to it while you're working out and you'll enjoy it. And as Anthony mentioned before, his devotion, boy. X, when you're talking, you know, you're hearing he coming from a deep place. He coming from deep inside. And that's what I admired about X, because even though, yes, he was singing gangster rap, and yes, he was he had a husky voice, and he was singing more killing this one and that one. When you really listen to him and his conviction, and when he's talking to you, I mean, it was like nobody was questioning DMX's masculinity. of how he was a rough rider, dogs, just get them boy and bitches and all that. But when he was moved so vulnerable, they could actually feel his passion. And he always used to be talking about his battles with addiction, how it's affected his family life. And those things stood out to me and DMX. Kevin, I see you reach back. You want to share your vision of DMX? What's your memory?
Right. So I was telling you all, boy, my best DMX experience. Club Coconuts, boy, college days, right? The whole crew, fellas, girls, everybody there, boy. And when I go in the club, I just want to hear soca and dance hall. I just want to jam. So when they start the hip-hop session, oh gosh, I vex, I go in by the bar. But boy, at this particular time, you just hear, dun, 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 dun. Boy, and the energy in the club just start to resonate. Dun, 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 dun. Boy, and everybody, you know, not, hey, dun, 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 stop. Dun, dun, dun. The whole club just start pumping at the same time, boy, yo. Mad. That was one of my best, boy.
If you didn't know the words, if you didn't know the lyrics, you learned it by force that night, you know.
Yeah.
Same thing to me.
That beat is so electrifying, boy.
You see everybody and everybody bumping, and I was like, what?
Yeah, from the time that beat dropped, any party wants that beat drop, it's so electrifying, it has hit everybody.
Yeah, but in researching X a little bit, I realized from his youthful days, foster care and what, he had it real hard growing up, boy. So yeah, no wonder he was always so gritty, angry. He had some real rough times growing up. So still, I don't think he ever got over that, boy. He always used to vent in his music and in his interviews.
Even in his interviews, I mean, coming up not so long ago, he had an interview where he was trying to be rekindled with one of his children, his son. And he was so deep in it, and you know he wanted to actually reach out, and he was telling his son he loved him, but you know his son caught up on his drug addiction and family life, you know, and the interviewer wasn't giving him that time and space to let him express how he felt, and X, like, he went crazy. He's like, woman, you can't talk for me, leave me, what were you doing here, let me talk to my son, you know. He was that kind of passionate guy then. He was, yeah. And that's what I admire, like, honestly, the most about him, his devotion to God and his music. Because Exa is one of the few artists who nearly every album had, like, Anthony, you could talk about this, had it's just hits after hits, going platinum and all of that. Talk to us about that, Anthony.
Well, that's the thing. I think X appealed to a wide cross-section of people, not only hip-hop fans, but also to mainstream rock and pop fans, because those obviously would be the people who would have bought his music in large amounts and could also go to concerts. And I think that whole, let's see, the whole dichotomy of being a hard rapper and still actually having some degree of sensitivity, and that, not only that, if you've ever seen, you've probably seen random DMX videos where you see people meet DMX and they actually meet him, and he's basically there showing them, he's basically showing them love. He's hugging them, talking to them, posing for pictures with them, taking the time to sit and talk to them. And from what I've heard, sometimes he would give money to charities, he'd give money away, and he's always saying that he didn't need a lot of material things. Even though he had a nice house, he probably had a nice vehicle, he would just, whatever he had, he gave for himself. And I think that actually attracted him to a lot of people, that drew him a lot of people. And not only that, when you talk to some of his friends or the closest people that he was affiliated with, they said that he was probably one of the most loyal, most faithful people. And that is what made him not only a star, but made him into the person that people would actually love and gravitate towards.
Yeah, Swiss Beast was saying that. He said material things. He said he would never buy a Jaguar. He would never buy the most expensive. Yeah, he would give and give and give everything he had, boy. Wow.
Even in his song from And Then There Was X album, when he sang Here We Go Again, you know, he was still talking about loyalty. You know, he's talking about just trying to mentor this young man in the game, and the man only wants to get money, and he was telling them, yeah, loyalty first, and then everything else will come, you know? So, yeah, Beecher, you're on point.
Now, after his death, an interview surfaced repeatedly with him where he was talking about how he was tricked into smoking crack.
Yeah, that's what People's Party would tell the quality.
Right. So I didn't see that interview prior to his death. Uh-huh. And when it came up and I saw it, boy, I watched this. Well, I listened to this man and you hear it in his voice with how he had respected the guy who did that to him. And you're hearing in his voice, he was cracking up. At one point, I see like he broke down. And you see the passion and how he felt. And he said he wouldn't even wish something like that on his worst enemy. And to know that one instance where this guy gave him the crack in the weeds laced with the crack, uh-huh, that changed this man's life and also took his life in the same instance. Well, when you think about it, it took his life as well.
Because I think even at his highest moments, when we looking on at him as fans, at his highest moments, he was deep in addiction, you know. But we wouldn't know. And that's to tell you how, like, people who we tend to pedestalize, they have it going on too, because they are humans as well, and they have our same struggles, you know. So it was amazing to see that, even though from so young that he was talking about that he was struggling from since then, and he was still ill, to be such a profound entertainer, a prolific entertainer, it's amazing.
No, the thing is, the other thing that we, what to your point, Kerval, is that a lot of times we do already see that background story, and is not only unique to DMX. There are lots of very talented artists who have had that kind of trouble when it comes to addiction, whether it be prescription drugs, whether it be cocaine, whether it be heroin, because we have gone as far back as probably Ray Charles. When we looked at Ray Charles, his biopic, Ray, he had an addiction to heroin.
Mm.
In terms of other artists, you hear about Kurt Cobain. You hear about, let's see, even people that we don't really know from. Whitney Houston and Bobby Brown. Even artists that we don't really know about, like when you hear about DJ Screw and Fat Pat, and they weren't even on heroin, but they used to just be using cough syrup. And while they're talented, they're using substances to basically numb whatever pain or internal conflict that they have in them, to a point where sometimes it reaches a point of no return.
Even sometimes, even if it's a numb pain, it was also used to, you know, to get the nerves under control right before they go on stage and stuff like that.
Yep.
But I don't know if we could juxtapose the modern day hip-hop artists, because now we seem to, well, a lot of them, to me, seem to glorify, whereas X was on it, but we wouldn't know. You know, nowadays when you hear them singing about using drugs, you know, being high, you know, this zip that we boy always have, you know, this kind of thing. So I don't know how I feel about the modern day artists now, you know, using drugs.
But that's just the modern day artists, you know, they glorifying the drugs and whatnot. And they're not understanding how detrimental it could be, because even though in the height of X using drugs and his addiction, he always used to be reaching out for help, because I think before this last incident, he actually checked himself in to a rehab facility when he felt himself getting a relapse.
Yeah.
X was cognizant of what was going on. He wanted that help, but is addiction then a monster or a beast that's so hard to manage that you can't really harness?
Sometimes without the proper guidance, it can, because not only that, when DMX actually went back into rehab to prevent himself from slipping back into it, it's because right before that, he had an overdose. And the only thing that they caught him in time, and he was revived using Narcan. So he knew of that near-death experience, and he basically didn't want to go down that road again. My guess is that he didn't have enough of a stabilizing force or stabilizing forces behind him to tell him, listen, we care for you.
Because let's be real, as much as we, you know, we're talking about X because he passed away and whatnot. X was really a character, you know. X impersonated an FBI agent, you know.
Yeah.
That's a good thing. He was really a character, so it's something that, and if he's battling out addiction from so long, I mean, that's something that is traumatizing for a family. So you're supporting them, you're supporting them, you want to be there for him, but how much as a family member could you really take? You know, you have to look at that side of it too. If, you know, every time he enters, yeah. into rehab, he comes back out, he's doing well, and then he has a relapse. You know, it could be painstaking for a family member. We're talking about drug addiction and support and how important it is for you to have the person that you can actually confide in, somebody to support you through your trauma or your stress of your addiction. And I would like to throw the question to you guys. How do you all think support fits into the whole recovery process?
Well, I think the support is paramount, right? I don't know. Well, I want to draw two local examples. We have one, Errol Fabian, who always calls himself a recovering addict, mm-hmm. right? Because you can't say you're recovered, right? Every day, one day at a time, day
you're
by
recovering.
Day,
take, right? Okay.
Yeah, and you know, you have that support system, and he would admit that, you know, it's a struggle. Every day, I have to keep focused, but he has that team and support and. Putting his energies into positive things, you know, it keeps him focused. And then we have another local soca artist that we know time and time again has fell off the map because of the drug abuse and whatnot. But again, because of
who's
support...
Who's that local soca artist?
Yeah, boy, I want to ask the same thing.
The veteran, right?
Oh, okay, go ahead.
Right? Yeah, and you know, he came back, you know, Superman, when he came back the first time, and he dropped off again, but of course with support and family help and a team behind him, he was able to come back and make that particular Friday the most fantastic day there ever was, right? He came back with a bang, but again, we cycle. So once you have that support behind you, I think anything is possible, but we have to remember that with substance abuse, it is a real struggle, a daily struggle. You could go 10 years without it, and then one day you just, and you're right back to the square one. So it's hard, and you really need that support to keep you around. Tell me, Ross.
Chef, I agree with you. Support is important, it's paramount. But I have a cousin, boy. Right? This man had the support, he had the family, he had everybody behind him. But this
and he's
man
still going to the gas tank.
Stop, boy. Boy, this man don't want to stop. He's still telling you, playing out, he ain't stopping. He doing what he had to do. He go hustle, he go thief, he go thing. There's real pressure with him. Where we supposed to do, eh? How long you think the family go support him? How long you think they go want to stay behind that attic who in trying to help himself? There's
in
always
words, chef,
carry a horse.
Do you think that the family have to be descendants of Job to bring all that patience to deal with that?
70 times 7.
I think that, you know, we have to go and source experts in this field so that we can have a deeper conversation about it. Because
yeah.
I think it's something that's very necessary for us to delve into. I don't want us to be here catching kicks on it because it's something that's very serious. And as we were speaking earlier about DMX, he was very vocal about his drug addiction and he wasn't shying away or hiding from it. You know, and the embarrassment of it and all that. He didn't study that. And that's something that I mentioned before as well as I admired about him, because even though he was someone who was seen as a role model or somebody, an idol, so to speak, he was still very vocal about his problems and about his faith and all of that. And that is something that, you know, we could take example from as men. Not necessarily be overly emotional, but at least able to feel and talk about your problems that you could ask for help. And DMX had no trouble in my estimation in asking for help.
That's the thing. The first thing is to admit that you have a problem. There's no progress for us here, cousin. I mean, he admitting, but he also admitting that he ain't stopping it. But no, you really need to identify that you have a problem, and you really need to have that big motivation, I guess, to want to be to be different, to want to make a change. You know, we were talking in the chat, and I remember you all saying, when you look back in hindsight, now, when you look back at DMX interviews, you could basically tell, yo, right. This man was real. Yeah, when you look at the agitation, you could see it.
And now
you
see that
clear.
Yeah.
He never say no. He hardly, well, in the early days, like Breakfast Club interview and thing, he's standing up right through, no seat, you know. He had to keep moving. They come like when Ray, as Beach mentioned, Ray Charles, you remember, he fidget. He had to keep, you know, itching, moving. So the telltale signs were there. And he was reaching out. And that's the thing. It takes a real man to admit, yo, I have a problem. I have a serious problem. Yeah.
What are your thoughts?
In terms of, there's another part of it where, for instance, now, as we may or may not know, DMX was married for, let's say, about 10 to 15 years. All right. So
that's why he was addicted to drugs?
No, that's not why he was addicted to drugs. What I'm saying is that he was married. Mm-hmm. But, and it is, to me, from what I've heard from his ex-wife, is that she tried to give him as much support as she could have.
Right.
And there's only so much that she could have done. Because remember, he also is on tour. He also is recording. He also is doing a whole lot of other things without them. And I think really and truly, he himself tried his best to pull himself out of situations where he would have had to battle addictions in a bigger way. So for instance, he was living in New York. He moved his entire family to Arizona so that he would be out of the environment, out of that street environment where he would be tempted by drugs, tempted by people in that zone. But apparently it still happened to catch up with him.
Yeah,
it still happened to catch up with him. So
do you think it's a little more difficult having that kind of stardom or star power to deal with addiction? Being in the limelight day in, day out?
Well, yeah, because you're also under a microscope. So you're basically trying to cope with being a normal human being, and you're also trying to cope with being a star that everybody has certain expectations of you. So your wife and your children have expectations that you will provide. Your label has expectations that you will deliver product. Your manager expects that you will come to promotions, do shows, do tours, and you have a set of people in terms of your entourage, your staff, and those people actually depend on you for a salary when the day comes. And that kind of mounting pressure on you, if you're not able to manage it properly, can turn into something that spirals out of control, especially if you have addictions that you want to feed in order to escape from it all. At least to my understanding of it. And I think that's probably where DMX fought a lot, because you're basically fighting with yourself, and you're fighting to be something to everybody.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, well said. I could see the pressure, the mountain pressure, the daily pressure that you'll be under being in such a situation. Yeah, for sure. Mm-hmm.
Well, guys, to the truth, I mean, in all of this, I think there are still some take-home messages that we got from DMX, apart from the hits that we always remember. Now that you know you're listening to his albums again, you know, it's sad or regrettable that you only start to delve into the albums when somebody has died or gone, and you haven't really, obviously you didn't really appreciate it while they were here, but you know, you get a little more appreciation for it now that they have passed, and you're getting into the lyrics and you're realizing, wait, but some of these songs he was actually dropping gems, you know? And I think one of the main lessons that we could learn from DMX is that even though DMX was this rugged person, Rough Riders and all of that, he still was vulnerable, like he didn't have a problem wearing his heart on his sleeve. And I think that's something that we as men could take from DMX. And, you know, allow ourselves to be vulnerable, allow ourselves to cry for help, allow ourselves to battle our demons, you know? And there's no shame in that.
And I think as men, we tend to try to keep things pent up and feel like, you know, we are men, we could handle it. But DMX, for nobody, I'm sure nobody could ever say DMX.
Yeah.
Never. And what is my biggest take home for me with DMX is his unwavering faith. You see his faith? Hey, you can't touch DMX with his faith. Regardless of who say he was bad, he was this, he was in jail, he's a junkie. He still had faith in his God. I will all, that's what stick with me. What about you, Chef? You have any?
Yeah, well, I think you hit the nail on the head there. That's one of the things. When you hear DMX pray, it moves you because he prays from a deep place, boy. I mean, it touches, it results. Yeah. You can tell he's praying from his heart. His soul, he put everything into it. So, yeah, Kovel, I just want to reiterate what you're saying there. If DMX, one of the hardest, toughest names we know, could be vulnerable, could cry, could show his weak side, could admit to being not perfect, to being weak, to having an addiction, you know, who are we? Who are we to not be open enough to admit the same? Right? And I think as Los Gents, as we always keep trying to change the narrative, and I hope that we continue as we open up, because we have done in episodes past, opening up. Some of us were close to tears. Some of us, you know, admitting our frailties. And we just want to engender that type of thinking in the men in society. It's okay. It's okay to not be okay. It's okay to talk about it. It doesn't make you any less of a man to say that you have a problem. So I think that's what we want to reiterate and underscore with this episode here. Yeah?
Yeah.
So real men express their feelings.
Realistic men do that. I mean, I really honestly don't think that men should be as emotional as women. It's not really our forte. But I really do think that men should be allowed to feel. Men should be allowed to be vulnerable. Men should be allowed to talk. And I think that's very, very important. And those of you who don't know who DMX is, YouTube there. Go and dig up a type in DMX, look for it. Trust me, you're going to find one you like. Not everything might resonate, but you're going to find one you like. I can guarantee that. Yeah? And Rossi, father, Rossi, tell your father buy back your CD.
I'll put it and I'll tell him. I'll put in the request.
All right, fellas. Well, once again, it was nice meeting, sipping, and chatting with you all. Cheers to another great episode.
Mm-hmm.
Right, and we encourage everyone to continue, like, follow, share. We are back, people. We are back, Los Gents. Season 3, The Triad. We are here. So this was episode 2. Looking forward to your comments. Right? See you all in the next one. We out.